Speciaaltherapeut in een psychiatrische inrichting. Begin jaren 80 onderging Coyne zelf enige tijd therapie. En daarna volgde een periode van alcoholisme en moeizaam herstel. Kevin Coyne woont inmiddels in Nuremberg en heeft zich ontwikkeld tot een gevierd beeldend kunstenaar. En brengt ook weer sterke platen uit. Loredan Musica zocht de onverwoestbare muzikant en schilder op.
When Jim Morrison died, of course, there's the famous story about Kevin Coyne, the Doors trying to persuade Kevin to become the new Jim Morrison, but anybody less temperamentally suited to that role, hard to imagine, I'd have thought. I used to live in central London, and people would come there and leave records and demo tapes and things at the door. And one day I came back, and this demo tape of a band called Coyne Clegg had been put through the letterbox, and I listened to it and really liked it, and had to leave a note on the door. And indeed, I went and stuck a few notes on kind of lampposts in the area in the hope of saying something like, you know, if you're the person who left a demo tape in my house, you know, please get in touch. He's continued doing what, you know, what he likes doing and what he does well on his own terms. The fact that he's still doing it now is indicative, I think, of, you know, some kind of integrity and you know, his creativity seems undiminished. He's a man who's made me laugh and he's made me cry. There aren't many people of whom I can say that.
See the redneck line the cotton streets, casting its roses around. Little old lady hang from windows, tears rolling right to the ground.
Ago, I worked in a mental hospital, and there used to be this mad woman who used to come into my office. Looked a little bit like this, and sort of red lips, and they're not so red, but shouting and screaming. Sad, really, but I mean, she was. But then somebody told me she'd been in Auschwitz or something. I didn't know this, but. Rather depressing, really, but I must still see this woman today with her you know, strange headscarf and red lips. I used to do art therapy. Not just art, but all kinds of therapy. I was called a social therapist, which is a rather grand name. I mean, I actually had art qualifications, but somehow I found this job, and somebody liked me and gave me this job. Talking about 1965 to around 1968, I thought, well, if I can't make a living as an artist, I might as well do something which is some service to the community. I mean, it sounds very idealistic, but I was. And it was a very interesting job, and I learned a lot from it. In fact, you know, a lot of my songs and other things reflect, you know, that period. I put on exhibitions of patients' work, and I loved what they did, many of them. I thought it changed my whole view about art, because art prior to this had been basically the academy and, you know, the kind of rather formal attitude to art. But the way they painted and the way they worked and that kind of directness of their approach to painting sick people was a very a revelation to me. And I learned a lot from it, you know. I mean, you've got guys like bank managers and who were sick, had schizophrenic interludes or whatever, suddenly painting large bunny rabbits and strange things they would never have done in their normal, if they'd have been, I suppose, well. Actually, I quite like this picture now. I'm getting to like it very much. If you've been in the kind of public eye in any respect in the music business, it's people have a real problem with it if you paint as well and draw and write. They can't.
They don't
know. No, they think it's kind of like a hobby or something. It's just a thing that's there, and it's very useful. It's a very practical thing. I consider myself in some ways fortunate to have this maybe ability and whatever to do this. But I don't think I'm any happier for having this ability either, I think.
The boy's got a nose like a carrot and a face like a fish. The boy's got a nose like a carrot and a face like a fish. Oh, to be happy. Oh, to be happy. Oh, to be happy is a lonely wish. And he goes to the church, goes to the church most Sundays. Goes with his little mother to the church on most Sundays. Wants to drop a bomb on his school most Mondays. Now I have to say this. This little boy has no saint. But he's my boy and I know he's no saint. But Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ, he'll never be. Jesus Christ, he ain't.
not a natural guitar player. I learned to play. I play my own way, and I kind of, in some ways, rather rudimentary to some people's ears and eyes. And it, rooted in blues in a way, but a little different. And so there was a sense of rejection sometimes. People thought, well, who is this guy coming and play the guitar with his thumb? And, this is not right, you know. But I really noticed that people liked what I did. The first album I did was for John Peel's Dandelion label, which was Kay's sister, I think, in 71, which was, 30 years ago now. I really do like my 70s album. Marjorie Razorblade sold a lot of copies all over the world. I think, by the standards of, the Beatles or something, maybe not, or even whatever, you know, but I think they were good, steady-selling albums. They were available and around for a long, long time. The cover for this is from the Hypnosis, the people who did all the Pink Floyd covers, and this was their vision of me, with this person jumping off the top of the building there. I think they must have paid some passerby to do that. But I'm well known for doing my own sleeves normally, but this is another one, which this album sold very well, Matching Head and Feet. This is what actually got in the top 30 in England, as I remember. But I can't remember the guy who did this, but at the time I used to wear these shoes a lot, and I think people still wear them today. Sort of, we call them brothel creepers. Yeah, and I think Virgin actually printed some mugs with my face, you know, some cups with my face on, so. And this one is the Sanity Stomp, which is an album I made around the period when I had a nervous breakdown. And this little figure here is done by my son, Robert. He drew this little thing when he was about 8 or something. Mm-hmm. And, and a picture on the back too. That was from Robert.
Laughing at me, but I wanna know why. I wanna know why.
And it seems that appearance does matter.
Into the army, Josh Schmidt, Bedrohung.
Wird damit berechnet, dass es eine Übergangsphase für DDC geben wird?
There are lots of questions that need to be asked in terms of what kind of jobs this has an effect and what kind of situations. How did they actually measure attractiveness?
Well, what are the things that you think make a woman or a man attractive?
Well, that's an interesting question.
Well, there seems to be quite a consensus about that now. In terms of meeting someone for the first time, so when you're making a first impression, a well-proportioned, fairly symmetrical
face goes down
very well.
What makes a woman attractive?
Particularly for women, are seen as being attractive. Relatively small nose and a fairly full mouth. And you need a sort of fairly normal body weight to go with it.
Mm.
But that first impression, that sort of positive feeling
bullshit.
We get for someone who looks
The first time I've heard about Kevin Coyne when I was with a friend of mine in Mexico for a holiday, and she brought a tape along with Kevin's songs, and I listened to it and I thought, wow, that's great music. And many years later I moved to Nuremberg and visited my brother, who lived in a very, very strange community. And they had the name Kevin Coyne at their letterbox. And I said to my brother, now I think you've gone completely mad. Now you even write Kevin Coyne on your letterbox. And he said, well, he's living here. And I couldn't believe it. And later I saw him and I thought, this is unbelievable. A great man like him, lost, totally lost. And he was like a very strange stranger here. Didn't fit in at all, and he had problems with his marriage. He was drinking heavily, and he was really at the end of the line. And he came to see a friend in Munich to go to this famous beer festival, the Oktoberfest. He was drinking very heavily, and it nearly destroyed him. And when I saw him, he was really half dead. He tried to stop drinking, and he went to Alcoholic Anonymous, and he carried on drinking. He went again, and then he stopped. So I met him then a few times, and I tried to help him just sort things out, because he has lost everything. You know, he didn't have any money, he didn't have any friends, and he was just like a lost soul. I mean, when you see him today, you know, it's, you know, you wouldn't believe it. He often says, you know, moving to Nuremberg didn't do his career any good, of course, because all these people he knew before, nobody really helped him. He was so sensitive, and I just thought he's a great artist, and this can't be, he can't go under, you know. And a man like him being destroyed by drink and by life and other people, this is not on. And I got very angry to see wasted talent.
I'm sitting in the corner with silly fat friends, waiting for the doom watch, they're waiting for the end. Wife is in the kitchen, sitting there in the dark. I'm out in the big world, surrounded by sharks. I need a best friend, or she'll never let me down. I need a best friend, or she'll never let me down. I need a best friend. She'll never, never, ever, ever, ever. She'll never let me down. Let me down.
But I think she's got a very beautiful face. I love her face, actually. And I can't really do her justice, to be honest. And, I think she's got such a wonderful warm ambience, she's a very tolerant and loving person. It shows in her face, I think.
Did you write some songs about her?
Yes, oh, several, yes.
Oh, I need a best friend. She'll never let me down. I need a best friend. She'll never, ever, ever, ever. She can never, never, ever. Never let me down. So I'm waiting for someone to knock upon my door. Tell me you're all right. Smile once more. Come into the kitchen. Make a cup of tea. Say everything all right, Kevin. That's the one I need. I need a best friend. She'll never let me down. Oh, I need a best friend. She'll never let me down. I need a best friend. She'll never ever. She'll never ever ever. She'll never ever ever. She'll never ever ever ever. She can't ever. She would never ever let me down. Never let me down. down. Never let me down.
Maybe I subconsciously blame music for the state I've been in, you know, I don't know.
That's an interesting idea.
I think in a way I did. But I loved, I love music, and I think my son made a good point the other week when he said, you know, for him, most people, it's 95% of their life is nothing to do with music. It's only a fraction of their life, but for somebody like me, it's almost my whole life, really. Because I think in musical terms pretty well all the time, and in visual terms. But much of this, but of course at that time, instead of music, I started painting, and I was producing hundreds of paintings and writing. I wrote two or three books during this time. And so much of my energies went into that direction.
Was it the proof that you could do without music?
Not really, I don't think so. But then again, subconsciously it might have been, I don't know. But I discovered I could make money from pictures and live from art, probably live from art. And so I concentrated on that. This arrived today. I think that's a basilitz on the front there. But just a picture of Steve Erlangen's just done this book, and there's one of my pictures in it. But it's next to a Picasso, which is rather nice, I think. I'm not such a sociable person these days as I was, you know. I'm not... You know, I'm not a guy for partying and rushing around. I used to be, but since I stopped drinking and then I stopped smoking, you go out and you feel a little bit out of place somehow.
People sometimes say the artist as a heavy drinker is very inspiring. I mean,
well, this is bullshit, really. I think I might have thought the same, you know, but, you know, I was reading a piece. I mean, there's so many of these great people like Dylan Thomas and Ernest Hemingway and all this. Most of them either committed suicide or drank themselves to death. And maybe they say, oh, they were geniuses, this was necessary for them to be that way. But I don't subscribe to this at all. I think that's an illusion, really. I think you do far better work without it. Although, I have to say, the stuff I did in the 70s on record stands up very well today.
Marjorie raised a blade. What a picture she made in her long and fusty dress, and the hair that she plaited best. What a woman, what a tongue, what an abrasive manner. And if anyone upsets me, let it be, because she's mine. Though she's over 59, she's experienced of the world far beyond my years. Mother me, Wallop, Marjorie, raise a blade. Mother me, Marjorie, raise a blade. Mother me, Marjorie, raise a blade. Mother me, Marjorie, raise a blade.
These are what you call your German records?
Yes, the German period.
German period?
Yeah.
Which started in?
Oh, about 86, I suppose, 80s, mm-hmm. 85. But I made some, you know, interesting things too in that time too. I mean, not all of it is by any means, you know, a waste of time.
Did you feel more comfortable with things you released recently?
Well, I have to say, where's the record for this thing? It's typical, you know, there's a bloody thing with a case on it. There's not, the record's not in it.
Don't blame me.
Yeah. Well, I think, you know, there was an attempt, maybe, oh, I don't know, somehow to sweeten things a little bit, you know. Not the real Kevin Coyne is something else, I think. Has a little more edge, you know.
And is he on the latest album you released?
Oh, absolutely, 100%. This is the real. This is why I like it. I'm going to put I'm Wild on. What do you think is that?
That's your latest.
Yeah, well, just to demonstrate maybe that.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
And you are still wild.
Yeah, well, not necessarily, but. Oh, no, sugar. This has got something to do with Kevin Coyne.
Kevin is always blaming me that I don't know his stuff, which is basically true.
But you do, of course.
No.
They are because he doesn't listen to his music at all, you know. It's basically verboten, you know.
No.
And as long as he's around, so there's not much chance that I really get into it.
Mm.
And of course, since we live together, you know, and I know the new stuff, you know, when he is recording, of course. But often, you know, on the road, people ask me about certain songs on which record and can they get this, and I always have to admit that, you know, I'm not so familiar, so I really feel a bit embarrassed, you know, and I try to learn. But I've got my, you know, favorite songs, like, as I said, No Romance,
yeah.
And I'll Put Some Roses in Your Room, and, yeah.
Yes, I mean,
so.
I mean, I think it would be a bit much to expect one's wife to have so much familiarity when you've made so many records,
and
you know.
And you can't remember yourself.
So. No, this is the truth. And I certainly can't remember the text of most of my records. I often see people in the audience singing along with a record, and of course I've changed the lyrics and they're completely confused, you know. But I tend to regard these things as living songs, you know, and they're mine, and I can interpret them and change the lyrics and do whatever I like with
yeah.
them, really. From West Virginia in the USA. And this is Robert Coyne, my son, from London. And this is James Little, James Jupiter Little,
a drummer from West Virginia too, from Charleston, West Virginia.
Forgive me for saying please. Forgive the way I am. Forgive me.
I don't know if you actually did it, but like beforehand we got together.
There was always music around when we were kids, and he was always working, writing tunes or whatever, and he's a very spontaneous guy, and that's his method, you know. It flows very freely from him, and this, I grew up with that idea that it was possible to do it. This was the way to be, you know. I think a lot of people don't understand that, you know, or don't know that you can, you know, music isn't something that somebody else does, you know. It was always in the house. I understood that it was something I could do. It's a very different method than anybody else uses, anybody else I've ever played with, you know, it's just entirely spontaneous. And that's quite, that takes me to, you know, I think I'm getting better at it. I think this new record we've done, I like quite a lot. I think it's a good thing.
But he comes up with lyrics and things and then...
Well, everything is done on the spot, you know, instantly. Initially, there wasn't a lot of contact, you know, because contact by phone, but my dad was in a bad way at that time, really, with drinking. And, you know, it had been rough, really, at home for a few years at that time. And the relationship wasn't as good as it is now. And, you know, it took a while to build it back up.
Tor André Flo has moved on. And a Celtic player. So Gudjonsson, who cost £4 million when he was signed from Bolton in the co-season, has the opportunity to stake a regular place.
Got the impression that you live like an exile in here. Is that
well, I feel like that to some extent, yeah. Yes. I sometimes feel like James Joyce in Paris or something. Maybe that's a little grandiose, but no, I do.
What keeps you here, though?
Well, Helmi, I think, as much as anything, and that's as good a reason as any, yeah, you know. And financial, you know, it's living in London and going back there, it's a very expensive place to go back to. Although I could, if I really wanted to, I could do all of those things and go back and reorganize things. And I'm thinking now of maybe my son, one of my sons has a place over there in Brixton in South London. I'm thinking maybe of going back and spending some time with him. Because, you know, Robert is working on my records and touring with me, so... I don't really know, but Helmi likes London very much, mm-hmm. So I
Would
think...
Would you join him?
Absolutely.
Yeah, you know, she'd be over straight away, I know this. And I mean, it's a great city, and you really can't compare it with Nuremberg. Nuremberg is provincial in many ways, but I love Nuremberg too. I mean, they've been very kind to me here, and... you know, I won the Culture Prize here, which was quite a lot of money in 1990. I think it was the first foreign ever to do it.
Was it for your art or for
my art and,
well,
and
I think for everything,
for everything I do. And there was a lot of recognition of, you know, what I do here, which is marvellous, which is more than I can say for my hometown in England, but which is Derby. But, of course, I've never lived there for years and years, and I suppose there's some reason for that. But it's... certainly, you know, they made me welcome, and I hope they really appreciate that. I have a lot of fondness for the Germans, I have to say that.
But
I get quite sentimental about it, sorry?
But at the same time, you, I think,
I wouldn't say you hate them, but you certainly talk about the war almost every day.
No. Well, I think anybody who comes from another culture, the war has to feature somewhere. And maybe not for Germans. Maybe they can thrust it, but to the back of their minds, maybe, I'm not sure. But one certainly living in a city like Nuremberg, one is reminded. It's not true to say I hate any of the Germans. That's not true. That's terribly wrong to say that. I feel very insulted when you say that. I mean, why did you say that?
Well, because sometimes you say very nasty things.
Yeah, but you'd say nasty things about the English if you had to.
No, sit I would never do that.
If you had to sit around while they, they close the bars too early.
But I appreciate that because I don't drink anyway.
Whatever, but they've got strange habits too. This is for sure, and I can get very angry about them too.
Yeah. You still feel like somebody in an exile, but a bit more comfortable now.
Yeah, sure.
Mentally, at least.
That's right. Yes, but I tend to think that I'm, maybe not so relaxed anywhere. Anyway,
that's true.
That might be the case.
Wherever
might just
you go.
Be me.
Yeah.
Might not be Germany. Might not be anywhere. The problem is probably me. But it's not a big problem. I'm used to myself. Whether others are, I'm not so sure. But.
Let your heart sing, let it take wings, let your little soul trill. Life is wonderful, super, every moment's a thrill. Sing to the clouds, late at night, don't let the dark get you down. Imagine you're a princess sitting somewhere on a long, tall seat with a crown. God watches over you. God watches over you. God watches over you. At least that's what he says he does. At least that's what he says he does.